Thanks very much for having me here today. It's a real pleasure. I work in an area of natural England called Change and Reform, and specifically I work on the BAT Reform Programme, or what we're calling the BAT Reform Programme, which is all about trying to find ways of streamlining the licensing process for bats so that we get better outcomes for better conservation outcomes for bats and better outcomes for stakeholders such as professional ecologists and developers. What I want to talk to you about is this partnership that we put together, including CIEEM and Bat Conservation Trust and Natural England, also supported by the Association of Local Government Ecologists, where we're proposing an entirely new system, or new and comprehensive system of earned recognition to support the bat licensing system. And we think that it has the potential to radically reshape bat licensing for the better. And we hope it will allow Natural England to focus on outcomes such as compliance and monitoring and far less on upfront risk assessment. But we want to hear from you today and over the next few weeks or with your thoughts on that. And I must stress, I'll probably stress a few times, this is very early stages. We're in the scoping stages at the moment. So I want to talk a little bit about perhaps the need for change, which many of you here will be all too aware of, how a new system of earned recognition might be able to help. I want to talk about the consultation, or this early consultation that we're going to have, which is launching today, and then we're going to have the Q&A session at the end. So why do we need change? There's lots of changes, aren't there, in the licensing system, especially for Natural England, which affects many people here. Can I have a quick show of hands? How many people in this room regularly deal with bats in a professional context? Okay, that's quite a few of you. And how many of you also apply for or work under licenses for Natural England? Okay, an awful lot. So I'm primarily talking to all of you about this, and you all have an opinion. So in terms of why we need to change, well, the issues will be very familiar here. The assessment and advice and decisions that we as an organisation reach can sometimes be inconsistent, I think we'll agree. Often because of lack of evidence and clearly because of the guidance itself has perhaps been taken in different ways. It can't always be applied to black and white situations. At the moment, the way we assess applications is very much weighted towards upfront assessment of risk. We spend an awful lot of our resource just making sure that your application is right. But we end up issuing pretty much every license anyway. We also have a problem where we can't always meet our agreed deadlines. 30 working days aren't always met. For various reasons, and as a result of spending a lot of our time up front, there's quite often less resource available, or no resource available in many cases, to actually check and ensure the outcomes for licences, and this includes compliance and post-licence monitoring checks. Monitoring data is often submitted, but because of the way we ask for monitoring data, it's very difficult to analyse, and we don't score it very well at scale. And we're missing huge opportunities for evidence to be fed back into the system. And the standards of licence applications we receive, many are very, very high standards, but we do get a great variety of those standards as well. So we think we can do better for bats. On that respect, we have tried to do some things with the current system, tinkering with the current system, and we've made some forays into earned recognition, and many of you will be familiar with the Bat Low Impact Class License, the BLICL as I'll call it from now on, it's easy to say. We also use class licences for bats and in other survey licences or class licences that use a type of earned recognition. We also have the Bats and Churches Class License, which is a very higher risk piece of a high risk license to mitigate the impact of bats in traditional buildings, HS2 class license as well. So what we do know is that It's an improvement on the individual license process, the traditional license process, which is quite burdensome, process heavy. It reduces handling time. It increases certainty for you as the professional ecologist and for the developers. So it's a good system in some ways. But it's only part of the solution. It hasn't actually reduced license applications significantly. Don't know quite why that is. You can see on the right here, we've got rust-coloured bars here which signify individual license applications in 2015. You can see the Blickle process starting and then coming up, and this final graph here is only January to October this year, so it hasn't quite reached the peak yet. And as you can see, it hasn't significantly reduced individual license applications. There's a number of reasons we can speculate. You don't fully know why. There's other issues with Blickle, is that we are in some cases not allowing the right people to have the own recognition status to be accredited to use this, and it perhaps rewards quantity of work rather than quality. So there's some serious issues, but I think it would suggest from our performance figures that it is a step in the right direction. But we can't just use our own statistics and experiences on their own to shape any new direction of travel. We also wanted to talk to our stakeholders, and we're in the process of doing that through different stakeholder groups. But we have had a talk with professional ecologists, people like yourselves, and some of the people in this room took part in our approach. And thank you very much for those that did take the time. We put together a fairly detailed list of questions, and we went for a very direct approach. So we interviewed over the phone, and we asked our wildlife advisors to do that, and that went very well. So in terms of, there was a whole lot of qualitative information. We didn't select people at random. It's not massively scientific, but it's a good insight into how bats cause bat regulation has an impact on the ecology industry. It gave us some good thought, some good thinking. So of the 25 that we approached, 18 were registered to use the Bat Low Impact Class license, and all of those people that were registered said it was good for their business. Because it cuts through red tape, allows small issues to be resolved quickly, greater flexibility, single bats no longer cause massive delays. So some good feedback about the current system, about the established bat low impact class license system. We also set a few scenarios, simple scenarios I might add, just to get an understanding of what the costs are in terms of money and time around the different licensing approaches. And a very simple scenario here, but as you can see, we asked what was the cost of preparing the license application documents for individual versus bat low impact class license, and you can see there's a big difference in terms of the cost. It's not scientific, okay? So it's very difficult to fully represent this 25 different ecologists, all from different areas of ecology, perhaps, and a spread. But it does give us an indication for the huge difference, disparity in the different processes and how one is perhaps more efficient than the other to interact with. So a massive difference in terms of £1,500 difference in terms of median cost, and 5.1 hours to prepare a Blickle application compared to 2.8 days for an individual license. In the information that we were fed back, We asked about what the biggest benefits were for the current system and what the biggest problems were. So in terms of benefits, and this includes both types of licensing. In terms of benefits, well, it ensures accountability of applicants. Blickle and own recognition were positive, good step, a good thing. Provides protection for the ecologist, and provides a level of protection for bats. In terms of the biggest problems, there's a much longer list, which I've distilled here. The application process is too long in terms of the forms, it's repetitive, disproportionate, slow, inconsistent approach to applying guidance, and far too many further information requests. Get all that, I agree with all that. And there's a lot of messages coming through in this qualitative data, mostly that we got, but what was coming through fairly loud and clear was there's a support for putting more trust in experienced ecologists. For a Blickle-like system, covering a wider range of impacts. And within such a system, more flexibility and an accessible criteria for ecologists. So we took all of this information, and for some time we've been, I think individually as organisations, as CIEEM, BCT and us, all thinking that earned recognition is perhaps that there's a lot of potential there for transforming how we license bats. So we've started scoping out this new system of earned recognition. And we're exploring the possibility of entirely replacing the existing bat mitigation licensing system. And the new system will cover the full range of impacts and licensing purposes for bats. I say will, this is just a proposal, so remember that all the way through this. This is a proposal and we want to talk to you about this today. So we want this new system to actually reward demonstrable competency with proper streamlined process and certainty about your interaction with the licensing process. We want then to free up this front-heavy system that we've got and refocus the resource on outcomes, and we really do think that this would be a better approach for bats and for stakeholders. So in terms of how it could work, well, at the root of it, we would like, we're proposing to take BCT's professional training standards for bats and coupling them with CIEEM's competency framework to create a fully comprehensive accreditation matrix. And assessment and accreditation would be based on evidence quality of work and skills within this matrix. So we're essentially proposing something very similar to the Bat Low Impact Class license, but scaled up to cover everything in terms of bat mitigation. So essentially, you would be able to see what level of competence you would need to be for what types of skills and experience to be able to do certain licensed activities. It would not be a one-size-fits-all criteria like Bat Low Impact Class license, where you're either in or you're out. It would be something far more comprehensive, far more user-friendly. We have learned our lessons from working, developing and implementing the Bat Low Impact Class license. And we hope that this system would have to enable professional ecologists, you, to gain the level of accreditation which is appropriate to your skills, your experience and your need. So what would this mean? Well, in a majority of cases, the need for an upfront technical assessment would be removed altogether, because that assessment would have been done by you, because you as the competent, trusted individual. This would allow us to focus, I said the majority of licences would be removed from the technical assessment. This would allow us to then, rather than a broad brush approach, which is what we do at the moment, assessing all applications that come in, we then reassess the risk and we focus on the cases that really do need the assessment, really do need that attention up front to ensure that they're dealt with correctly. The higher risk cases, the ones that have a greater conservation concern or conservation need. And this approach would mean that most bat licenses, bat license applications would or could be in effect if our systems could support it, granted almost immediately. And would allow us to shift our resource onto compliance and monitoring, so on an outcomes focused approach. So in terms of how you would gain accreditation, well, we would have an assessment framework which might use a variety of tools which we have suggested here. Again, we haven't fully worked this through yet, but this is how we think it might work. We would have tools such as online and field testing. You might be able to submit a portfolio of evidence such as logbooks, project reports, and undertake professional review interviews to improve your level of competence. The accreditation would be certified by experienced assessors, and most likely we would have a pool of independent lawyers, say assessors, that would be governed by a competent authority, perhaps Natural England, perhaps someone else, but it would be a it would be set, they would be, they themselves, these assessors themselves would be certified and subject to rigorous quality control to ensure that they deliver a quality product, essentially. How would we maintain standards? Well, we would require all professional ecologists to be members of a professional body. And this would happen in CIEEM, or a body with, and very importantly, to state equivalent quality assurance, competence standards, and disciplinary capabilities. And that's very, very important. And there is likely, there would likely be a need for a periodic reassessment of users of this system as time goes by. So that's the earned recognition, or that's our scope when it comes to, or our proposal when it comes to earned recognition. But that's only part of the picture. In order to fully transform the licensing process, we need to also address monitoring to ensure that we have that we can get the information about the licensed work that we've allowed to take place. It's not covered, we're not wrapping the monitoring project up in exactly the same project. We have to split this up into sizable, bite-sized chunks, if you like, so that it's achievable, but it's an integral part of this overall programme, in that we have to reform how we undertake monitoring, and we have to do it differently. So this monitoring project will explore how we standardise pre- and post-licensing survey data to allow for easier analysis. At the moment, you're all probably very aware that the monitoring data that we gather is very difficult to compare to pre-licensed survey data. So it's very hard to actually assess what the impact of the work really was on the population of animals. We need to improve our data collection, our data storage and access. So that's largely a technology issue there. And we must ensure that data is regularly analysed and the results fed back into the system to improve practice standards. So that's gathering the evidence and making sure we learn from it. Not just every now and again, all the time. And by radically transforming the earned recognition, the front and the back half, if you like, of the licensing system, we would then have a modern licensing system, I hope, which would lend itself much more readily to a fully online system, which is where we would like to be at some point soon. So the objectives to this work are, we would hope that this would deliver better, much better protection for bats. There'd be much more compliance monitoring. The monitoring data would be consistent, accessible, and regularly analysed to provide the evidence that we need, especially for bats. The practice standards would improve. Everyone would work to the same high standards. They'd be accountable to the same high standards. And service levels would improve. Licenses would be issued, in most cases, immediately. And there would be a greater certainty for developers and professional ecologists. What are our timescales for this work? Well, we're at the scoping stages now. We need funding for this work, and we will, and we're going to be putting it together, a business case at some point soon, based on the feedback we get from ecologists, and based on the information that we're putting together now. But we hope, if we could get funding by April, May, June time next year, we're hoping that we could develop the project throughout the latter half of 2018, go out to a detailed consultation at the end of next year. Once we finished our consultation, we'd like to run a pilot to see how the entire system would work in practice, and that would be in 2019, with a view to a staged delivery in towards the end of 2019. To really, and that would, I think, in something as quite radical as this, you couldn't just deliver and then walk away. It would need to be a very staged, strong delivery, which would require quite a lot of time to bed in these new processes and ensure that they're being fully used and embedded in. So that's our proposal. We are seeking feedback from you and from all professional ecologists who work with bats, not just CIEEM members. We put together a very short consultation on SurveyMonkey, and we've provided some background information to that on the CIEEM website, and the link to that is there. So if you go there, and that link will also be in the next issue of In Practice magazine, and we're going to tweet that, hopefully through Natural England, BCT and CIEEM. Anyone who wasn't in this room today will be able to read all about the proposal and then click on a link at the bottom and take you through the SurveyMonkey, and you'll be able to fill in and give us some feedback on what you think. What are your thoughts on this approach? Do you like it? Don't you like it? What do you like it? What don't you like about it? And we've asked for a few suggestions as well in terms of, if we do take it forward, how what it might look like. I'd like to stress that this is an early consultation. This isn't in any way a detailed consultation, and we will be having a detailed consultation, as I pointed out, if this is taken forward into the development phase. So that's the consultation, or the early consultation, should I say. One last thing to say then is thank you very much for listening. We would be very pleased to take your questions. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And joining Steve on the panel to take questions are Lisa Kerslake from CIEEM and Dan Collins from Backman Associates. So, there are lots of hands in the outreach.
Jane Sally from Acon. My big, big question, is there anything similar in the pipeline for GCM?
I think I'd have to say I don't know on that at the moment. There's obviously the landscape, district licensing for Utes, that is being bedded in at the moment, and I have a feeling that the proposal is that deals with the majority of licensing for Utes, so that is the approach that's been taken for Utes, but I wouldn't be able to comment any more on that. It's not something I've been fully involved with.
Thank you. Next question. I've got one right at the back there.
I'm aware of at least what you might call four old-stager bat ecologists who aren't members of CIEEM. What would their future be after 2019? Would there still be the old system that could be run in tandem for these sorts of individuals?
Sorry, I didn't catch the last bit of your question.
Yeah, would there still be the old system in tandem with the new system for these people who, for whatever reason, are not members of CIEEM?
Okay, I think to actually get good outcomes for bats, we've eventually got to have a system that works for everyone. So I think eventually, and there will be long lead-in times to allow for people that aren't currently members of any professional body, but I think eventually we would be asking that everyone was to sign up to a professional body, because membership of a professional body reflects that you're all professionals in your industry, and you are working to some fairly high standards that, that do change and do improve as time goes on.
Lisa, would you like to add anything?
And just to say that I think we would have to phase out the old system eventually. I think I'm right in saying that. But as Dina says, there will be an interim period. And this is very much about raising standards. It's very important to us that, that standards are raised across the profession. So it is fundamental importance that we get the standards and the levels of this right.
Thank you. Next question, please. No,
Hi, I've just got a question. At the minute, with regards to local licences, if you haven't been on the course, and I've spoken to a representative from Natural England, it's very difficult to get information with regards to what jobs might or might not fall under the local licence. Is it going to be more open and transparent with what jobs might be able to fall under those or not?
Well, this will be a fully comprehensive new system which will cover all licensing types and areas. So the accreditation matrix, if you like, that we're going that we're proposing to produce would cover everything. And so it'll be quite clear, I hope, from the outset about the level of competence you are required to achieve to undertake different types of jobs, if you like. Does that answer your question?
Is there any reason then why that information isn't available now for the local licence, as in what
yeah.
could be done under the local licence, so that you would know whether it needs an EPS at old school or whether it could fall, even if you're not registered to use local?
I mean, obviously, this is a question about our current system, which is, and I can't really comment on. I think it reflects the difficulties in the current approach that the current black low impact glass license is one license, which is part of the bigger system, and it's not fully committed, if you like. And what we're proposing is something that is much more committed, will be much more open, and you will have much more resource to understand what you can and can't do, if you like. For the outset, but I can't really comment on how the current system is working or why you're not seeing the information you need to see. I'm sorry.
I just wanted to say about transparency as well that that's really, really important to us, and that's why we're all set up here now, and that's why we want to gain your opinion from the early stages of this. So.
So, Caroline Wilson, I just wondered if there'd been any parallel discussions with the other country and SMCBs regarding this sort of approach to licensing.
Yes, preliminary. I haven't talked to my colleagues about this yet, so sorry. But yeah, I know SNH are interested in expanding their use of earned recognition, and I have had a few email exchanges with NRW as well. So we think we want to get our understanding of what this project would be and how it would work sorted, and then I think we would see if the other SNCOs would be perhaps interested in having a play in it of some kind, yet to be defined.
I was just wondering how the BAT expert panel fits with this
film. Yeah, yes. So the BAT expert panel, for anyone who might not know, is we've set up. We haven't yet had a first meeting, but we've set up a panel of experts. We've selected 10 eminent BAT experts from around the country to form a panel in which we want to play out our BAT reform programme with or to, and really take into account their thinking so they can help steer us so that we are really are sort of listening to our stakeholders, if you like. So this recognition project is something that we want, that we are going to put past the panel at the first meeting in January. And we get to decide how we're going to frame it, but yes, it's going to be one of the first pieces that we want to talk to them about.
Thank you. We've given you a panel. Has anybody got a question for Jan Lisa? One hand on top of it there. Jan Lisa question.
I'll adapt it into a BCC question. Tony Martin, consultant. One problem that we have with young consultants is then getting experience at handling. Because if you're doing consultancy properly, you should always be minimising disturbance. You can use DNA to give you accurate species identification. So there's the potential for people coming through not having much handling experience, and then they're either risks putting onerous weight on the local back groups if consultants are going to there to get handling experience, or you could see a clear gap arising in people doing that type of work. And also, if you're a good consultant, you go for a long time without handling by yourself if you're always using the best possible technique. So any ways forward on that one?
I think, I absolutely agree that, we should be choosing non-invasive techniques in the first instance. In terms of getting people accredited in different skills, we need to look at what training is provided. I would like to see less concentration on people getting training with back groups, really, and make sure that we do have the professional training courses available. I'm not sure if we want to add anything to that.
Just to say that the training to support this scheme, if it goes ahead, will be absolutely vital. And as Jan says, part of that will need to be looking at the way we deal with training, and bat handling is a classic case, which has for many years been somewhat random, shall we say, in terms of how people gain that experience. And yeah, it's very important that is tackled.
Thank you.
I've got
a question, actually.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to come to
Hi, if I could just follow on from this, actually, it's sort of linked, but my experience, or at least my understanding of a low-impact class licence, is that to hold it, to be able to do low-impact on individual pips, for example, you have to have held a licence for about 5 different species, including experience of maternity and hibernation use. And again, whilst I agree it should be given to very qualified people, if you are a good consultant, I think a lot of the time, depending on the circumstances, you try and avoid needing a license by avoiding effects on maternity roost or avoiding effects on hibernation roost, or you may have had extensive experience with 2 or 3 species. And I was just wondering how, I assume the matrix will look to perhaps accredit you for particular species or particular circumstances, and whether that's going to become very complex, or whether it actually might mean that people who currently hold licenses for development may no longer be qualified. I was just wondering how that was going to sort of work out.
Yeah, I'll start from this and then it's going to happen if I want to, but I hold a local licence and I'm registered to use local. And yes, that is a criticism of the current system, but as students have earlier, we're very much learning from that, and the idea is that there will be different categories this goes ahead. So you might have somebody who is licensed just to deal with pips and barangongies for the sake of, that's totally off to my head, I'm not saying that is a category, we've said we're going to do this. That's why we're doing this, to ask you guys what your views are. But yes, and it will be very much a different categories. And yes, it might get a bit complicated and we might have to sort of think about that. But it's very important that we learn from local and the things that have come out that haven't been perfect, shall we say.
Just trying to think what I can add to that. But I think that we don't want a system that ends up being more complex than it is now. Clearly, that's a no-no. We have to have something where we don't have any computer says no situations. We need pragmatism. And I think that's got to be involved in designing this system. And ultimately, we've got to rely on the you guys, the professional consultants, to make the call. I think is important, and we're putting trust in people to do that, and that's the basis of the system.
Hi, I'm Kelly Hopkins from Playgirl Cinnamon.
Similarly, following on from that lady's comments, just it sounds great, especially for consultants that have got decades of experience and lots of licences under their belt. But for somebody like myself, who's only been in consultancy for a few years and hasn't got lots of licences, would it be similar in that you have to be an accredited agent on other people's licences and then have references to be able to earn the recognition status?
Well, I think that the current approach relies too heavily on numbers of licences, and that surely shouldn't matter. It should be all about how about skills and experience, and the whole point of having an independent group of assessors is that your skills and experience can be assessed, and that's not about whether you've held 20 licences, because you could be an incredibly skilled, and many people are, and knowledgeable bat worker and never have held a licence, and we have to have a system that reflects that.
I'm going to completely overstep the boundaries as chair now and say, if you think about the model of being the CIEEM competence framework, where what we're asking you to do is demonstrate that you're competent at something, that you have skills and you have the relevant knowledge and experience and you can apply your professional judgment, that's completely different to saying, I've held this particular qualification before, or I've done it so many times for so many years. So it really is moving towards recognising people for what they are able to do rather than for what licences they've held in the past. Right, another one at the back again. I'm going to allow you a second one because there's no other hand at the moment. And now
thank you. It's more of an observation than a question, is that I applaud the approach to try and streamline things across the board. Just a word of warning about, be careful, don't dumb down too far. The more experience I have with individuals who operate on nickel, and also natural England's encouragement to low conservation status routes, no compensation or mitigation and or food back boxes, we don't want to throw the baby out of the bathwater.
Okay, so I think you're basically saying, are you not, that we don't want to give too much of a free rein because we might end up seeing lots of minor roosts being destroyed perhaps and no compensation being put in place, and almost to the point where single individual bats are being, maybe a red rooster being destroyed. Is this the kind of the gist of your question?
Yeah, that's basically it, because as I said, I rub shoulders with a lot of nickel license holders, and by default, that's all they have to do to discharge their conditions or expectations. And what we don't want is a plethora of bat boxes all over the country that hardly any bats are taken out.
Well, I think the system that we're proposing is backed up by and supported for standards, which will improve and change as evidence is gathered in an ongoing nature. So I think the beauty of the new system is that we will be able to adjust the standards to ensure that people are doing the right thing for bats and getting good outcomes. So that is then becomes much more in our power to do that. Okay.
Right, can we take one more question?
Sorry, Steph. I think the other thing about biblical, you don't need the compensation, you don't necessarily need the monitoring. Obviously, as Stephen said during the talk, we want to kind of couple this with the monitoring project, where we make sure that we are getting all the right data to be able to analyse outcomes for that. So that's a really important part of this. And I think this will replace the biblical system entirely. So some of the issues around that system, as we've said, the lessons will be learnt from that.
John Box. As someone who's been involved in great testing system for 20 years, and deeply involved in two major rail scheme-wide licences for great testing routes, I love this new approach. The focus on the competence of the individuals the outcomes from the projects and Natural England doing compliance monitoring. I think it's superb.
Thank you, John.
As a sort of finger in the air at this point, I hope you will all go and join in with this consultation. I wonder if you could just give us, on the basis of a show of hands, where you're feeling about this at the moment. Not on a detailed system or how it would work, but on the principle, as John's just described very eloquently, of moving to the system of real recognition. Can I have, first of all, those people who feel that they're very positive about the system of recognition? Thank you very much. Somewhat positive? Neutral? Three? Somewhat negative? One? And very negative? Nobody. Then panel, I think you've done an extremely good job in explaining to you about how this might work. Thank you all very much for contributing to that discussion, and please do get online and contribute to the consultation.